in the Eastern Division.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Baseball All-Star Flashback. Tonight, we'll take a look at two of the most recent All-Star games, 1981 and the 1983 Classic, as well as the more humorous side of the sport with Mr. Baseball himself, Bob Uecker. First up, the 1981 Midsummer Classic.
The baseball that will begin the 1981 All-Star Game. Anticipation is the watchword for tonight's celebration of the national pastime. As game time approaches in Cleveland Municipal Stadium, the excitement mounts. And players and fans alike are thrilled that Major League Baseball is back. The pregame ceremonies are equal to the glamour of the event. The celebrated ball is safely delivered. The world's largest American flag is unfurled. And the biggest crowd in All-Star history looks on. Cameras click. And both teams are ready for the midsummer spectacle. So are entertainer Bob Hope and Vice President George Bush. Dallas Green's National Leaguers have the confidence of a team that has won 9 in a row. But like Green, 14 of his players will be making their All-Star debut. The American Leaguers have lost 17 of their last 18. And it's been suggested that the team is jinxed or hexed. But there's no time for speculation. The game is about to begin. A record crowd of more than 72,000 is on hand to greet the Stars. Like Hall of Famer Warren Spahn, the National League's honorary captain. The biggest cheers are for Cleveland Stars, like another Hall of Famer, Bob Feller, captain of Jim Frey's American League. And there's more cheers reserved for Vice President Bush, ready to throw out the first ball, an All-Star tradition. Tonight's catcher is 13-year-old Derek Williams, chosen at random as a representative fan. The vice president, a former Yale first baseman, lets fly. And Municipal Stadium's fourth green game becomes real. Leading off is Philadelphia's 40-year-old Pete Rose, an all-star for the 15th time. And one of baseball's greats of all time, a ball player extraordinaire. 18 years in the majors for a man who always goes all out. Rose began with Cincinnati in 1963 and was Rookie of the Year. Batting titles followed in 68, 69, and 73. And defensively, the versatile Rose had the highest lifetime fielding percentage of any outfielder ever. But history may remember Rose best for his hustle at home to win the 1970 All-Star Game. Now, another All-Star Game, 1981.
First baseman, Pete Rose.
For Rose, a record fifth starting position in All-Star play. Detroit's Jack Morris is on the mound. And 58 days after the last big league swing of the bat, Pete Rose swings true. A leadoff hit for the man whose previous hit during the regular season tied Stan Musial's all-time National League record. But in the top of the first, Rose was stranded. In the bottom of the first, 20-year-old rookie Fernando Valenzuela of the Los Angeles Dodgers starts for the National League. Leading off is the California Angels' Rod Carew, who, like Pete Rose, plays first base. And he's been here before, too. Rod Carew in 1967 was the American League's Rookie of the Year with the Minnesota Twins. He made the All-Star team that season and every year since, running up a total of 15 in a row. A multi-talented performer, Carew is always a threat on the bases. His seven batting crowns are surpassed by only Ty Cobb and Honus Wagner, and his .332 lifetime average is the highest among all active players. Rod Carew is a fan favorite with a record 27 million all-star votes since the balloting began in 1970.
Leading off, first baseman Rod Carew.
Quite an ovation for the American League first baseman batting first. Rod Carew's sixth base hit in his last eight all-star at-bats. Quite a percentage. But the law of averages catches up on the bases, and at the end of one full inning, it's the National League nothing, the American League nothing.
The gold.
Nickelodeon.
And Nickelodeon.
Something speaks for themselves.
Smooth and mellow taste tells you all you need to know. Michelob. Some things speak for themselves.
Somebody's buying your brain. You know it's Ozark. We're out there buying your way. The way you want to fly across the USA. Every day,
serving over 60 cities coast to coast, border to border.
With the game still scoreless in the bottom of the second inning, another distinguished all-star makes an appearance.
Pitcher Tom Seaver.
Cincinnati's Tom Seaver, who earlier in the season recorded his 3,000th strikeout, is now ready for his eighth all-star game, which ties a record for pitchers. And his first challenge is against Baltimore slugging switch hitter Ken Singleton. A power hitter against a power pitcher. A classic duel. And Seaver gets two quick strikes.
Come on, Kenny, rip it down.
The count is nothing and two. The American League strikes first. And it's a 1-0 ball game. Singleton's home run is the 113th in All-Star history. And the jubilant Cleveland crowd seems to sense that this might be the American League year. In each of the three previous years, the American League couldn't hold an early lead. But tonight could be different. Third inning, and standing tall on the mound, Cleveland's very own Len Barker, the overwhelming fan favorite. The enthusiastic hometown support of Len Barker is matched by his impeccable performance over the next two innings. Faces only six batters, and his performance is perfect, reminiscent of his perfect game 3 months earlier on the same field. The highlight of Barker's performance was his duel with slugger Dave Parker in the third. One bad pitch could have tied it. Nothing in one. Now a pitch, no balls and two strikes. After wasting a pitch, it's one and two. Still a pitcher's count. But Barker just missed it. The fourth straight hit at or below the knee. And now, for the count two and two, the challenge. The American League strikeout leader has done it, and done it in style. And his team still hangs on to its one-run advantage. Top of the fifth inning, still 1-0, and California's Ken Forsch is the new pitcher.
Batting for the National League is Montreal Expo catcher Gary Carter. Carter is facing one of the game's best control pitchers, but on this particular pitch, it's Carter in control. The score is tied 1-1, and National League fans get their chance to cheer. In the dugout, Carter's teammates offer their own spirited congratulations. It stays tied in the bottom of the fifth, and then in the sixth inning, Mike Maris comes on for the American League. Dave Parker bats for the first time since the Len Barker strikeout, and the Cobra is coiled. In a game of inches, Parker's roller hits the edge of the grass, and Buddy Bell's gold glove is rendered helpless. Double jeopardy. For Dave Parker, opportunity knocks twice. And this time he answers the call with a vicious drive. Long distance. Parker's home run is especially memorable since coming on the heels of such a strange foul ball. The American League appears snake-bit as the National League now leads 2-1. The Dodgers' Bert Hooton, who retired three in a row in the fifth, is now the pitcher of record, and he faces Ken Singleton. For the fourth time in six innings, the American League leads off with a hit or a walk. Red Sox slugger Dwight Evans, having his best season, is next, and Hooton must now work from the stretch for the first time. Evans' base hit puts the potential tying run in scoring position, and there's nobody out.
Catcher Carlton Fisk.
Chicago's Carlton Fisk is hitless in two tries and has only one hit and 13 all-star at-bats. But this time, he loops one to load him up. Trailing by only one run and nobody out, the American League is urged on by this huge Cleveland crowd to break the spell. California's Fred Lynn is sent up to hit, and the stage is set. Second baseman Manny Trio saves a run, but it's the American League's fourth hit in a row, and the game is tied 2-2. Texas Ranger Buddy Bell is next, and the former Indian is well remembered by the Cleveland fans. No outs. The bases are loaded, and it's a critical moment.
The American League for 9 years has hoped for the big inning that could break up the ballgame, and now is that chance. With the count full, Bell hits what appears to be a certain double playground, but a second look reveals that the ball bounced off Buddy's foot, making it a foul ball. Just like with Parker in the top of the inning, the matter of an inch or two makes all the difference. Only this time, the American League has gotten the break. Bases loaded, no outs, full count, 2-2 ball game, and Buddy Bell has another chance.
Get out of town!
A sacrifice fly, and the American League regains the lead, 3-2.
Batting 7th, catcher Gary Carter.
Gary Carter, who homered on the first pitch of the 5th inning, now eagerly awaits the first pitch of the 7th. Strikeout artist Ron Davis of the Yankees gets the call. Winfield gets to the wall, but not the ball. And all of a sudden, the National League trails by only one. In his last two at-bats, Carter has seen two pitches, and both times he really liked what he saw. The Expo catcher becomes only the 5th player in All-Star history to homer twice in the same game. And coming only one pitch after Baker's diving catch, Carter's homer also demonstrates the game of inches. The ball was just beyond the reach of Dave Winfield's valiant try, but had it fallen one inch shy, it would have stayed in play. But now it's a one-run game. In the 8th, Milwaukee's Raleigh Fingers comes in to do what he does best. At age 34, number 34 has saved more games than anyone in baseball history. But in this game, Raleigh lets his Fingers do the walking. And with one away, Pittsburgh's Mike Easler becomes the tying run. Jim Fry is only 5 outs away from victory. But up steps the premier home run hitter in the major leagues, Mike Schmidt. Going, going, and it is gone. And so is the American League lead. The National League is on top 5-4. For the 4th inning in a row, the senior circuit has hit for the circuit, an all-star record. Schmidt's blast traveled more than 400 feet, and the National League's leading vote-getter on this year's ballot is accepted at home by his very own national convention.
Nice God.
Give me a light. A Bud Light.
If you just ask for a light beer, you never know what you'll get.
And I'll have a light. A Bud Light!
So if you want the less filling light beer with the first name and taste, don't just ask for a light beer.
Give me a light.
Ask them to bring out their best.
Bud Light.
Bud Light. Because everything else is just a light.
It's the bottom of the 9th inning, and the National League's 5-4 comeback lead is entrusted to the St. Louis Cardinals' Bruce Sutter. Sutter won the 78 and 79 All-Star games, and then settled for a save in 1980. Now, a chance for another save, as Sutter, who works from the stretch regardless, looks in at leadoff man Frank White of the Royals. Guarding the line is Pittsburgh's Bill Madlock, who turns a third base grounder into a first base out. One away. Pitcher Dave Steeb of Toronto must now bat for himself as the American League has used all its pinch hitters. Steeb, who has batted only once in the major leagues, gets his second chance here and becomes out number 2.
Dave Winfield.
This is it. A whole game full of opportunities has diminished into one final chance.
and Dave Winfield is the last hope. Three balls, two strikes, two outs. The bottom of the ninth, and the American League's down by one. The ball game is over, and for the 10th straight year, the National League has won, this time 5-4. Most of tonight's record crowd is disappointed with the outcome, and after a look at the American League's recent All-Star history and a few of the strange bounces in this game, you can't help but wonder. But winner or loser, jinxes or not, the fans agree that the game was hard-fought and exciting, and it's good to have Major League Baseball once again.
We hope you enjoyed the look back at the 81 All-Star Game. We'll come back with a visit with Mr. Baseball, Bob Uecker.
Watching Sports Time, Mid-America's Sports Network. Sports Time has a weekend to watch starting Friday night. Watch AAA Live as Indianapolis takes on the Redbirds live from Louisville. Saturday afternoon, it's a Sports Time exclusive with special coverage as the world's fastest boats race for the coveted Indiana Governor's Cup. From Madison, Indiana, the hydroplanes are racing. Then Saturday night, Sports Time heads north as Pete Rose and the Expos host the Cincinnati Reds and Dave Parker. Then Sports Time is back in Montreal Sunday afternoon as the Reds wrap up their series against the Expos. And Sunday night, NASL action continues as the New York Cosmos kick it out.
Has created a lot of the heroes for young men growing up, which they could use for role models. But what about adults? Are they immune from this type of daydreaming? Well, most are, but one man who isn't will be your guide to a fantasy tour of the All-Star Game, Bob Uecker.
And Gossage is all set. A 3-2 Yankee lead. The 1-0 delivery is hit in the air. Cooper swung at a high pitch. Andre Robertson, the shortstop, pounds the glove once, makes the catch, and the Yankees take the finale. So the final score, the Yankees 3 and the Brewers 2. Gossage picking up a big save tonight, and the Yankees take the final game in this three-game series. The final game before the All-Star break. So until then, Bob Uecker saying, so long, everybody.
We're off the air.
Ah, nice job, Mike, out of way.
Buddy.
Nice steps. Atta baby. See you later. The All-Star Game. It's all a fuss anyway, the All-Stars. I really think there's something special, those guys. I know Lasorda and Martin do, and they're only the managers. Now that's something I know I can do just as well as they do. Hey, come on, Coop, let's see you take him deep. We need the big one, Coop, come on, baby. Come on, Coop, hit him deep. Coop, that way to hit the ball. Baby, all right, that ball's out of here. Way to go, Coop, that a boy. Hey, come on, money man, let's see you bang him again. Come on, Donnie, hit one deep. Come on, Donnie, bang him. Come on, buddy boy.
Yeah, all right, I knew this was going to be easy. All right.
Hey, Gorman, come on, baby, three times, the hat trick. Come on, Gorman, take him deep. So the Brewers have gotten back-to-back home runs from Cooper and Money, and Zahn will now face Gorman Thomas. And the pitch to Gorman, he hits to deep left field, back toward the wall. It's got a chance to go. It is gone for Gorman Thomas. Three in a row, and Bobby's bangers are at it again.
Well, this thing's working on offense. Let me see if I can get something going on defense. All right.
Come on, gang, we need two. We need two. Turn a double play. Let's go. So the Brewers have really looked good under new manager Bob Uecker, but California has something going here in the eighth inning.
Carew, the runner at first. Bob Boone, the batter. The stretch and the pitch to Boone. Here is a swing and a line drive headed toward the gap in right center. A long run for Gorman Thomas. A diving grab, and he's got it. They've got a chance to double Carew off at first. The throw coming to Cooper, and they got him. He got it right. He was out. Man, this is like stealing candy from a baby. This is easy. I'll tell you something else. I knew I'd get these calls. Umpires loved me when I was catching, and they still love me now. Not like these other managers. All these guys do is disagree.
In a way, haven't seen you in a while. How've you been? Have you changed your style? And do you think that we've grown up differently? Don't seem the same. Seems you've lost your feel for me. So let's leave it alone, 'cause we can't see eye to eye. There ain't no good guy, there ain't no bad guy. There's only you and me, and we just disagree.
I got a big mouth. I could handle this action. I could handle this.
You're out!
I'm out! You're out! You gotta be kidding me. How can you call a guy? Come on, will you? The guy's got the plate right here. Are you kidding me? Come on, will you? There was no way. That guy couldn't throw out Wallace Berry.
At the 10.
If that guy's out, I'm an underground aviator, buddy boy.
Get out of here!
You're... For what? I'm out, but you're a better man for it. You're kidding me.
You call that arguing? You get run from the game, and all you can do is walk back here smiling?
I'm not smiling. I'm aggravated.
Well, let me tell you something. You can only get thrown out once.
I thought
you
I did a decent job.
You can't get thrown out twice. So if you get thrown out, you might as well get a little creative.
Well, what am I going to do? I thought I did a decent job.
Let me show you something.
Oh, well, here he comes.
Let me show you what I mean now. By the first thing you do is get right up in their face, you point the finger. Then if you can't get close enough, you turn the hand around and kick some dirt. And then if he's missed a strike, you get over here and you put dirt all over the thing. You throw the hat down, you pick it up, you throw it, and then you're so bad, you throw him out of the game. You're out of here. That's the way a major league manager should.
I learned something, but
should get thrown out of the game, just like
you
that.
You are a maestro.
I thought it was good. I don't know.
Man, that was beautiful. I can't believe you did that. I got to look at that one more time. I'm going to slow it down a little bit this time, too. That was great.